We should begin. Good morning, everyone. So this morning, we'll be doing something quite a bit different than we did yesterday. So first of all, where's John? Thank you, John, for yesterday. Today, we have before lunch two panels. This one is called Wisdom in the West, Some Basics, and the one after the coffee break is Wisdom in the Dharmic Traditions. I'll speak only for this panel, but it may also apply to the second one. This is going to be a kind of irresponsible romp the Western tradition. So I think you'll see that we are not here aiming for a comprehensive treatment of wisdom in the West in our respective 12 minutes, but rather to give you some salient moments and some provocations to spark conversation. So the order will be Angie will speak first, then I will speak, then Tom and Anne, and roughly that's ancient, modern, I don't know exactly everything. So without further ado, I hand it over to Anne.
Thank you very much. Can you all hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Excellent. Well, I've been given the happy task of going over 1,000 years of ancient Greek culture and philosophy in about 12 minutes, but we are not daunted. We will charge on. So a few brief words on Homer. So in the Iliad and the Odyssey, what's interesting is we get lots of different kinds of wisdom and knowledge and expertise and different kinds of words from them. So, for instance, when they want the wise advice of the experienced old guy, they go to Nestor, the oldest of the warriors out in Troy. He's always praised for his wisdom. He's wise about the bigger picture. He can take the long view. He's the one who wants to reconcile warring Achilles and Agamemnon. He's the diplomat. But his practical advice isn't always very good. He quite often gives wrong advice. For instance, his advice gets Patroclus killed, apart from Achilles sulking in his tent. So he's wise, but he's not perfect. And then, of course, contrasted with Odysseus, the picture of him in the Iliad and even more in the Odyssey is he is polytros, meaning he's got many resources. He's the Odysseus of many wiles, is the epithet that Homer or whatever person or people are called Homer uses of him. So different kinds of wisdom, different kinds of skill are needed. Gender's also really interesting here. Of course, most of the main characters in the Iliad and the Odyssey are male, but the goddess of wisdom is, of course, Athena, a female, which is intriguing. We saw this a bit yesterday, actually. Though if you look at the iconography of Athena, according to the gender stereotypes of the time, she's portrayed in what the Greeks would have seen as a very masculine mode, with breastplate and weapons and a helmet and very, what they would have seen as very masculine musculature. So we've got quite a bit of gender fluidity there. The Greek gods and the Greeks in general are very, very on trend with gender fluidity. Right, so skipping lightly on a couple of centuries. We're now in the 6th century BCE. We're with Pythagoras, the semi-mystical founder of Pythagoreanism. We think there was probably a historical origin to Pythagoras, born in Samos, but trying to escape Persian rule, takes his band of followers off to southern Italy, sets up part academic, part hippie communes in southern Italy. They do serious work on music and maths. They're also vegetarians. They believe in reincarnation. They live a lovely communal life. He's the person, or Pythagoras and certainly his followers, who move the debate on from Sophia, wisdom, to philosophia, love of wisdom. And according to Cicero, much later, of course, writing in the 1st century BCE in Rome, in his Tusculans 539, Cicero says that Pythagoras is the first person to call himself a philosopher, a philosophos, not a sophos, not a wise man. He's aiming at wisdom. He loves wisdom. He's not claiming it. Okay, now on to the 5th century BCE, Athens, Socrates, of course. For Socrates, virtue is knowledge. big claim. Knowledge of what? Knowledge of the human good in generally different... knowledge of the human good in general, but in different contexts. So the virtue of courage, for instance, is knowledge of the human good in contexts of risk and harm and danger. Socrates says that the... And this, we think, is the historic Socrates, says that the two main ethical questions are how to live, how should I live, and what sort of person should I be? What we now call an ethics of virtue and flourishing, based on the concepts of eudaimonia, flourishing, and aretēia, which John was telling us about yesterday. So Socrates is interested in how to live well. And part of that, he thinks, is how to die well, which is interesting. How to die well, he sees as part of the good life. Mm. There's a Socratic theory variously known by scholars, depending on their interpretation, as the unity of virtue or the unity of the virtues. The unity of virtue, that's if scholars think Socrates believes that virtue is simply one thing, knowledge of the human good. Unity of the virtues, that is the scholars who think that Socrates thinks that the virtues are codependent. If you have one, you have them all. Happily for us this morning, we don't need to worry too much about that. We've got very interconnected virtues. It's to do with knowledge of the human good. What we need to be concerned with are the implications, because if virtue is knowledge, then of course vice is going to be ignorance. No one does wrong willingly is one of Socrates's most famous and controversial sayings. It has a lot of implications for ethics, for penal systems, for legal systems. And he says the good man, and indeed woman, we'll come on to that in a moment, never does wrong. So the good human never returns wrong for wrong. One of the historic Socrates's most famous sayings, which early Christians have thought was one of the reasons they believed Socrates prefigures Jesus in some way. It clearly prefigures Matthew in the Sermon on the Mount. Never return wrong for wrong. Absolute repudiation of the Homeric code of revenge. Help your friends and harm your enemies. Again, interesting gender issues. Socrates is very clear that the virtues are gender neutral. The general Greek view was that some virtues are very male, that their word for courage, Andrea, literally means the kind of behaviour and qualities appropriate to a male, which is linguistically interesting for when they want to call women courageous. But Socrates won't have any of that. He says that all humans can be virtuous. How do you achieve it? As we were hearing yesterday, the techniques that John and John's colleagues have been developing have their roots in Socratic dialogue, question and answer. So it's not surprising that there are some notable similarities between John's methods and those of the historic Socrates. Though John was also clear that his methods are not intended as historical reconstructions, there are a few differences too. One thing that both John and his methods and the historic Socrates have in common is the importance of aporia, perplexity, doubt. You start off thinking you know all about a subject, you're questioned, you find out you don't know what you thought you knew. It can be painful, but it's an important phase to go through. I think we started at 7 minutes past, so I'm intending to go on till for about 6-7
Angie,
minutes.
Don't worry.
Okay. No. I'm used to radio programs just cutting me off. Right. So we've got the importance of Socratic dialogue, question and answer, the importance of acknowledging perplexity, doubt, that kind of humility. You might not associate humility with Socrates, but it's an important part of the technique. Mm. And that leads us on to his pupil, his friend, well, Socrates would have said not a pupil, but the guy he mentored, Plato. And this is also true of Plato's methods, and we'll come on to his methods in about 1.5 minutes. But I want, first of all, to talk about the content of Plato's theories about wisdom. For Plato, wisdom is knowledge of the form of the good. The form of the good, as I'm sure you know, is a perfect, eternal, non-sensible paradigm of goodness. And it's knowledge of that form and how you apply it to various human contexts that constitutes wisdom for Plato. The philosopher who searches for this is to be sharply distinguished, Plato says, from the sophists, those professional traveling teacher, professional teachers of philosophy and rhetoric who made a lot of money. For Plato, philosophers are all about a collaborative search for truth rather than how to defeat and humiliate your opponent, which Plato thinks is the aim of the sophists. Not entirely fairly, but a bit of fairness. So it's a collaborative search for truth. You're not aiming to win, you're aiming to find out the truth. Also gender neutral for Plato. Remember, in the Republic, we have not just philosopher kings, we have philosopher queens too, yay. And in the Symposium, the famous ladder of love leading us to the form of beauty is given to us by a mythical quasi-priestess called Diotima. Strongly religious flavour, which is interesting for this weekend in Plato's vision. The form of the good is divine, and trying to emulate it in yourself and in society is what he calls in the Theaetetus, trying to imitate God. Very radical thing for Plato to say. A more traditional Greek view is put by the lyric poet Pindar that humans should think human thoughts. It's hubristic to try to imitate God. Plato and then Aristotle, his pupil, have a different view. We should be trying to imitate God as far as we can. Those two threads go right through Western thought. How do you set about this? Philosophy, says Plato again in the Theaetetus, begins in wondering, the act of wondering. The world is just so extraordinary and beautiful. Dialogue, again, is very important. He tries to recreate the Socratic oral technique in his written dialogues. Though, of course, one difference between Plato and John and his colleagues and their methods is that in Plato, what he calls dialogue is supposed to lead to dialectic. For Plato in the Republic, but he's interpreting dialectic a bit differently from John and his colleagues, but it's dialogue leads to dialectic. Plato never speaks in his own voice, and he's therefore inviting us in to the conversation. We all have room in the conversation. Learning has to be internal. It has to be an active internal process. You can't just say, I'm an empty vessel, guru, fill me up with wisdom. That's not how it works. All the teacher can do, says Plato in Republic, and we've seen this image before this weekend, is turn the pupil in the direction of the light. That's all a teacher can do. That's what teaching is, turning the pupil in the direction of the light. We've had that image, have we not, of the heliotrope, the sunflower, this weekend. I've mentioned this to John. One issue where I actually interpret Plato a little differently from John is that I think Plato's actually pretty good at the imaginary. Using the characters in his dialogues, he allows us to imagine different lives, different choices, different personalities, different outcomes. Another crucial point to emphasize is in Plato, there is no reason-desire split. That's an early modern split in Hume, in Kant, and so on. For Plato, the tension is between rational and irrational desires. Reason desires the form of the good. It desires to emulate God. Reason is passionate. How many seconds left?
Yeah, almost 15 minutes.
Okay, I've got one more minute. Okay, so I just wanted to finish, because it will lead us on to some of the early Christian thought we're going to be looking at in 1 minute. Stoicism, really important for this weekend, I think. So the Stoics start in Greece in the late 4th and the 3rd centuries BCE, and of course it's then taken up in Rome. So they're thought by some of the early Christians to prefigure Christianity in some interesting ways. So just in 45 seconds, Stoicism. We live in a materialistic cosmos, that's obviously not Christian, interpenetrated by divine rational fire, which has arranged everything for the best. Our individual human reason is a spark of this divine reason, and our task is to understand how everything has in fact been arranged for the best, and accept that something which appears terrible now is in fact part of this greater providential plan. And as rational beings, this is really interesting for our weekend, we are all connected to all other rational beings in what they call the cosmopolis, the world city. And if we understand and follow all this, we're living in accordance with nature, resonant with those of us who tried to practice yoga this morning. And our virtue and happiness lie in this. So Homer to the Stoics, we're done.
Bravo. Okay. Bravo.
All right, thank you. Thank you, Angie.
That's probably the maddest thing I've ever had. Yeah, that,
I think that was a romp. Through
it was a romp. That was it a was romp. A romp. It was a romp.
We made
are
it.
Not daunted.
Okay, so it falls to me to take up a different storyline, an adjacent and in some ways a contemporary storyline, but one that goes slightly later than what Angie just walked us through, which is wisdom in the Judeo-Christian tradition. And I'm going to land on five moments in that history, one from the Hebrew Bible, one from Gnostic mythology, and three from the history of Christianity fairly early, 3rd through 6th centuries. And I think the thread that I'm trying to find in all of these or highlight for us is the personification of wisdom. The word for wisdom in Greek, Latin, Hebrew, Aramaic, and Arabic is a feminine noun, which invites the personification of wisdom as a woman. And what I will touch on are moments of that personification, but I want us to ask us to think about how significant is it for us to think about wisdom as a person, and more specifically, as a woman? So there is a body of literature in the Hebrew Bible that is called wisdom literature. There's Tanakh, histories, prophets, and then a collection of literature that is sort of broadly about the conduct of life. The most famous book of which is probably Proverbs, attributed to King Solomon. And in the early chapters of the book of Proverbs, we're introduced to two characters, Lady Wisdom and Lady Folly. These are two women who take up a position outside of their respective houses in the high point of the city and call to the citizens as they go about their lives, enticing them to enter their house. Lady Wisdom calls to passersby and beckons to them to a life of rectitude and morally right conduct. Lady Folly is sort of figured as an adulteress and prostitute who calls to passersby to come into her house wherein death ultimately lay. So these two characters will reappear through especially the Christian tradition as sort of figures that sort of structure how we think about and how we pursue wisdom. But curiously, in what I'm going to call Gnostic mythology, they seem to be collapsed for a moment. So what's Gnostic mythology? Gnosticism, without going down a very long rabbit hole, is a name we give to a movement that sort of spans early Christianity, some forms of early Judaism, and some forms of paganism as well. And the mythology that ties them all together includes the view that the world we're inhabiting is a world created not by the ultimate and benevolent God, but one created by
a ignorant and malevolent sub-deity. And that sub-deity, that God who is responsible for this world, which is clearly shot through with all kinds of error and mistake, that God is actually the offspring of wisdom. Now, this is kind of curious, because in Gnostic mythology, the divine realm is called the pleroma, the fullness, and it's constituted by a god and his heavenly court, which is supposed to be a perfect number of what are called aeons. Think of them as gods that surround the one god. But that perfect realm of the pleroma is disrupted by wisdom. The aeon, wisdom, presumes to give birth without the permission of her consort, her male consort, and she gives birth to the god who rules our world. Now, this is interesting because here in Gnostic mythology, it looks like Lady Wisdom is involved in the primordial act of folly. And much of Gnostic mythology is about undoing the catastrophe that wisdom wrought by breaking ranks with the other gods and presuming to give birth without permission. Now, all of this can be interrogated. I'm just reporting it. But there's also a way in which the entire cosmic drama then becomes about not just righting the wrong of Sophia, but saving Sophia. Sophia, or wisdom, has somehow fallen and needs to be restored. Okay, that's the second moment. The third is the formation of what we call Christology in early Christian thought. Who is Christ? Now, Christology starts as early as the New Testament, right? The New Testament has many different accounts of who this figure, Jesus the Christ, is, Jesus the Messiah. But it picks up in early Christianity in the 3rd through 6th centuries. And the thing I want to focus on today is the way in which Christ is thought of as divine, right? Christ is human and divine, but how is he divine? He is clearly not God the Father. He has something to do with this secondary aspect of God called God the Son, who is variously identified with the Word and the wisdom of God. And I want to focus on the wisdom of God for a moment. The wisdom of God and the Word are both thought of as sort of emanations of God the Father. But as we've just talked about, wisdom is a feminine noun and is actually personified as a woman in Proverbs. The book of Proverbs, in which wisdom speaks in the first person about her origins, in early Christianity, that first person account is taken to be the Christ speaking of his own divinity before his incarnation. What does that mean? That means that the wisdom of God is the divine aspect that instantiates in Christ. Or to put that another way, Christ is the incarnation of God's wisdom, which means that Christ, a male Jesus of Nazareth, is somehow the incarnation of the very divine feminine figure that is personified in Proverbs. So what does it mean to personify wisdom? What does it mean to personify wisdom as a woman? And then what does it mean to imagine that personified woman embodied in a male, namely Jesus the Christ? That's the third moment. Okay, the fourth and fifth moment are from much later, the 6th century. For Angie and me, that's quite late. Boethius is a very successful politician in 6th century Rome who falls afoul of the Ostrogothic king and finds himself imprisoned and looking down the barrel of execution. he writes a book called The Consolation of Philosophy. It is, I'm not sure it's the, I think it's the first instance of prison literature. It's the first that I can think of book we have of someone writing from prison, which then goes on to have a very distinguished history, of course, that genre. But in this, in the sort of the depths of his despair, he is visited by Lady Philosophy, who comes to him to offer consolation as his very promising life has just come to ruin. And they run through some classic problems like predetermination, free will, the problem of evil. It's very curious because this is a Christian writer, but The Consolation of Philosophy has almost no explicitly Christian content, and the consolation he is offered is by essentially pagan Platonist philosophy. So there he is meeting Lady Philosophy. And then finally, I want to say, in the 6th century, that was in Rome, in New Rome, just a few years later, the Emperor Justinian decides to create, to build what will eventually be called Hagia Sophia, or Holy Wisdom, the largest cathedral. It was the largest cathedral when it was finished in 537 until, I believe, the cathedral in Seville, 1,000 years later. It's enormous. But it was also something of a surprise that he would dedicate this church to Holy Wisdom. Because Holy Wisdom was, it's not common to have churches to Holy Wisdom. The one thing I want to say about this, which I hope will set up Tom and Anne a bit, is that, I have the book here if anyone's interested. A Byzantine art historian by the name of Bisera Pencheva, who teaches at Stanford, has done an amazing research on Hagia Sophia. If you've ever seen it, it has this enormous central dome. She has been working with historical astronomers and scholars of acoustics to argue that Hagia Sophia was actually an elaborately designed sound and light show, to put a sound and light show. She has been able to track the way the movements of the sun cast light and shadow over the course of the year, how the Byzantine liturgical calendar mapped to that moving light around the interior. She's also been able to recreate do research on the acoustics of Hagia Sophia with Byzantine chant, which actually dissolves the semantic quality of words when they reverberate and echo, so that the chant loses its syntactic meaning and just becomes reverberant sound. Plus, of course, everything is smoked to hell because it's incense. So the overall picture of Hagia Sophia, on her account, is that this is essentially a state-sponsored liturgical practice of inducing transcendent states in practitioners. Sound, light, smoke. And what that has to do with holy wisdom remains an open question. Okay, I think I'll pass the baton. Yeah. Over to, not the church I grew up in, I'll tell you that.
Yeah,
not Protestant for sure. Minnesota. Okay, Tom.
Okay, so Charlie said I should do Sophia from Burma to Corbin and beyond. Well, I added the beyond. And I wrote it because I knew I couldn't do it otherwise. My task is to evoke the mystery of Sophia as she has been imagined by a few adventurous souls in the West from Yakob Burma to the present. I will attempt it by refracting her image in a kaleidoscope made from fragments of the visions of many people who will here necessarily be anonymous. I, of course, am the maker of this imperfect instrument. Where is she? between the transcendent and unknowable deity and the literal world of history, physics, and the ravages of fate, there are other worlds, at least as real as the one we seem to know. They are intricate webs of entangled, subtle bodies, each the manifestation of a person. And there are persons of every degree, from the most dense and rudimentary being of a slab of shale, to the brilliant erotic glories of the angelic countenances. These worlds are the dwellings of revealed divinity, and in her totality, she is sometimes called Sophia, the face of wisdom. Her presence is the soul of the worlds. Who is she? She is the in-between, the between us, mediating transcendence and immanence, and so personifying relationship itself. Her relationality includes all beings in their various mixtures of darkness and light, and this begins her cosmic story. In one Gnostic myth, quote, the sufferings that befell her took the form of various emotions. Sadness, fear, bewilderment, confusion, longing. Now she laughed and now she wept. End quote. The drama unfolds her manifold personalities, refracted differently in every time and place. Her manifestations include Eve, Helen, Mary, the mother of God, and Sophia herself. Her great mythologies define the theater of metamorphoses that we have come to call psychology. So she is also known to us as psyche, anima, and soul, that magical energy that causes life and draws us into relations. With her cunning play, quote, of illusions, the soul lures into life the inertness of matter that does not want to live. She makes us imagine incredible things that life may be lived. She is full of snares and traps in order that we should fall, should reach the earth and entangle ourselves there and stay caught. That's Jung. She draws us into entanglements and relationships with every being we encounter. We are embedded in psyche, in what we call imagination and fantasy. So we live in fertile confusion, surrounded by presences whose weird attentions we largely ignore. In this blooming, buzzing confusion, we can sometimes, with great effort, make out a bewildering variety of her personalities. Two consequences of her presence are primary. As anima, she personifies our unconsciousness, our stupidities, follies, intractable problems. And here is the strange miracle. She is the source of our feeling of personal interiority, and she brings the sense of having an interior life, of being me. Your autonomy is a fiction. She makes possible our sense of personal reality. She personalizes existence. And because her consciousness is mythical and magical, she pluralizes the persons of our psyche even as she makes us feel our individual reality. Her presence reveals that the smallest unit of being is two. That's from Kaya Silverman. We cannot survive without an other. Whether we conceive of this primary other as anima or as angel, a daimon, a genius, a fravarti, or a paridros, she is indispensable to our personality, and without her we are lost in vagabondage and perdition. The poles of this archetypal dyad are mutually constitutive. The manifest angel needs her corresponding creature as a creature needs its angel. A further mystery ensures that this relationality cannot be captured by intellect. At the heart of each person, angelic, human, animal, plant, or mineral, lies an atom of the unknowable and hidden God. Thus, each member of the pair can say, and this is Ibn Arabi, I am known only by you, just as you exist only by me. Who knows you knows me, although no one knows me, so that you too are known by no one. This unknowable kernel of mystery is the enigmatic origin of love. But this isn't a love that unifies. This cosmological love is what we can call imaginal love. And in these worlds, when we love, we want to explore more and more widely, to extend the intricacy that intensifies intimacy. That's James Hillman. This loving comes first ontologically. Only through love is it possible to recognize persons and to experience our place among them. A key to understanding this fundamental ontology comes to us from Lou Andreas Salome. In a letter to Rilke, she wrote, "We became friends hardly by choice, but rather through a subliminally consummated marriage. Two halves did not seek completion in each other, but a surprised whole recognized itself in an unfathomable totality." Stunningly, she extends this primordial kinship, saying it is, quote, "not limited to human beings alone, but opens simultaneously even to the dust of the cosmos." This is the love towards which Sophia points. So how do we find her? Two halves did not seek completion in each other, but a surprised whole recognized itself in an unfathomable totality. The primordial dyad is not a dualism, and so it points towards the metamorphoses that dissolve the schisms and binary oppositions that have caused so much damage. The surprise is the energy of the eternal Eve, the motive force of love and creation. And that can never be the result of two halves forlornly seeking completion in each other. That completion signals closure. Creation is not closure, not need. Love is not needy. The cosmos is not needy. It's alive. A dualism explodes into a pluralism. An analogous transformation occurs when we realize that literalism itself is a mode of imagining. So that dualism, the literal and the metaphorical, both disappear. Literal truth, certainties, fundamental realities, these are all merely hard but temporary little nubbins congealed for a time in the living cosmic fire that we lamely call imagination. It is necessary to have such fictions, but they are mutable and not absolutes that we imagine them to be. Likewise, another binary can be pluralized. The characteristics that are variously grouped together as masculine do not collectively name one half of any whole. They are better seen as faces of some of the many persons of the divine. As the literal is an essential fiction, so is the presumed unity of rationality, power, control, force, and stability, or whatever other traits may be suggested. So many of the attributes of what are called him are better imagined as faces of the goddess. She is the matrix, the mundus imaginalis, the metamorphic countenance of reality. If any of this is to be useful, we need to know how to encounter this confounding person who is the elusive source of all that we are and may be. To meet her, we can begin by giving thanks. We won't find her by seeking, but perhaps we might by showing hospitality for a stranger. For strange and alien, she certainly will be. If we are capable of welcome, we will find that humility and humor come as part of the package. And then we'll be prepared for life in the society of beings who animate the world. Conviviality introduces what might be the most important intuition of mystical theology. You can't enter the world of the imaginal by housebreaking or by rational thought. You have to expand the thought of the heart so that the doors of your perceptions are open and your entire sensorium can resonate as if receiving arpeggios charged by distant lights. Understanding in the deepest sense is participation and communion, and communion takes the form of music. These thoughts from John Coltrane give us both joy and a mission. He said, "I think the main thing musicians would like to do is give a picture of the many wonderful things that they know of and sense in the universe. I think that's one of the greatest things you can do in life, and we all try to do the same."
Okay. May this be useful. So I'm always really suspicious. Now, Tom, I'm sure I can't offend you. Tom has also assured me I cannot offend Charles. Angie, forgive me. So I'm always really suspicious when a bunch of men get together and publicize abstract concepts in the form of a female person. And as you know, I'm a musician. So I've come at this issue in a little different way. And I think I have something different to offer. Let me just get to the beginning of my notes. I have notes. Okay, so I think all of you know the project that I've dedicated my professional life to, which is Voices of the Pearl, which is commissioning music, which Tom very, very nicely ended his talk with, to texts by or about esoteric female practitioners. So whenever I ask someone to supply me a text, the first thing they give me is something said by Sophia or Saraswati or some divine creature who's female who's said something, and then I have to say, no, that's not what I'm interested in. I'm interested in the actual women who went through this process of enlightenment and then left instructions or reports or somehow hopeful, helpful breadcrumbs, I think it's a breadcrumb, for the people who came after, not just the women, but for the people. And they're quite difficult to find, those women. There's no catalog of all the women in the world who've left stuff. And often it is at these conferences where I talk to each person and explain what I would like, that I actually find those texts. And that's starting to happen, and thank you so much for any suggestions that you have. So in trying to find something to say on the topic of personification, within the larger topic of wisdom and pedagogy, I guess my first confession is that when I'm up there performing and speaking singing the words of these women, female esoterics, I hope I'm not feeling that I'm personifying the divine. Okay, and maybe the audience is having some sort of idea that I'm personifying, because all performance does kind of involve the actor, the performer, in some sort of personification. But that's not my goal. I'm doing it for a much more selfish reason, is because it allows me to investigate this tradition of female lineage that is so little known about. I see some of you nodding. I mean, until I did this project, I had no idea that there was this collection of writings by and about women called the Terigata at the foundation of Buddhism, right? I had no idea that there was this figure in ancient Sumeria called Enheduanna, who is apparently the first named author in our entire world that we know of. I had no idea, and she's also the first named composer, the first named astronomer, the first named priestess. There are all these things that accrete around this author. I had no idea until Charles suggested it to set Thunder Perfect Mind, which is set in the first person feminine. I had no idea. And I thought to myself, my gosh, if I have no idea, a professor who's supposed to be educated at a women's college, no less, how can I expect my students to know anything about it? And probably most people, actually women or men, don't know about these women. So it seems like a good idea to put them together in a kind of catalog, which somebody, another professor, has called rather, kind of loftily, a resource in the humanities, and have this pointer for women particularly, but hopefully not just women, but for women who are interested in instruction for us humans who are wearing the female body in these practices that lead towards the divine and enlightenment. Because there are instructions that people have left before us. And that is, I think, one of the, from outside religious studies, that is one of the major reasons religions form, because somebody has a radically mystical experience that is considered useful. And then how do we get the next generation to be able to experience this? And I think we are right now at a point where we want a large number of people to have a spiritual renovation of sorts, so that they can approach what is coming or is actually here already, sort of this atomization of the individual and confrontation with the digital as opposed to the human, with some sense of themselves as a kind of gyroscope, like a being that is not going to be blown about by all of these chaotic forces that are confronting us. So I am actually hopefully going to end each section of this talk with a question to you all, because one of the things I'm really hoping that we come away from this gathering, because so powerful to have 50 people here, right? 50 people who are all really interested in some aspect of spiritual transformation, I think. How do we prepare the next generation to cultivate a spiritual sense of self? How do we even introduce to those students, many of my students don't believe in the spiritual period. And how do we do that without causing people who are already religious, already have a tradition, to be offended or to feel that they're somehow being excluded, but also those people who don't have a tradition, how do we offer that to those people who don't have a religious tradition? And how do we do it safely? Because, many of the personification practices, I consider personification of the divine to be a kind of gentler form of sacred technology, where you prepare the ground, just as I consider virtues, contemplation of the virtues to be a preparation, a grounding for then a transformation that is mostly not about words, is mostly smells and bells, like Hagia Sophia. It's mostly sensorium, like a cascade of uncontrollable sensations that you are basically riding. And That is the moment of wonder and awe that I'm hoping to bring to my students somehow, those who wish to pursue that, you know. So it's not that I think that the work that you're doing in Dialogos or the history and the cultural exegesis of all of these traditions is not useful. I'm not saying that. I'm saying that it is the foothills of an experience that is so transformative and can be so beneficial that it's worth trying to figure out how to produce. And I don't know if the word scalable is the right word, but like I'm just hoping that it's possible to do it on a kind of large scale. I see so many of my students who are depressed or, you know, some even in the last few years committing suicide, and I'm just like, you know, if this experience were available to them and they had the option to try these sorts of things and it was accepted and taught in our higher education system, then maybe that kind of thing would be much less likely to happen. Okay, so back to my notes. All right, so because I come from the performing arts, so I'm a musician, right? You know, I'm a singer. I also have done a lot of theater work and, you know, a little bit of dance. I'm not so good at that. I happen to know that the embodied performance disciplines are the refuge of these experiential practices in higher education right now. There are so many experimental, and some of them totally fruit loopy, okay? I mean, it's hard to kind of discern. There's a problem, right? Because you don't know actually which practices are gonna work for which students, but I mean, there are things, for example, in theater that verge on very intense rituals that I would think belong maybe in religion, maybe nowhere, okay? if you listen to, for example, some of my friends who worked with this Polish director, Grotowski, where he took the theater students into the woods, dug holes, and buried them for a day, okay? And you know, you have the little air tube, right? Those experiences were highly transformative.
Yeah, don't do it.
Okay? Yeah. 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 I mean, okay, so.
All right, everybody. Settle down.
you may think, oh, this is only happening in these weird marginal schools. No, it was Yale. Okay, and at Harvard and Yale and other actor training schools, they are doing this type of voice work that I teach. Called Fitzmaurice Voice Work, which is based on the work of Wilhelm Reich. Okay, so, right, okay, the Christology is different. Like, the first, apparently, you know, the first part of his life when he was thinking about bringing psychotherapy to the masses, right, everybody's on board with that, and then he starts doing these things like cloud busting, which I kind of see resonances of in some Taoist texts, okay? But okay, let's just put a pin in that. I'm not accepting the second half of Reich's work as my gospel, but I've seen remarkable transformations in the students who do this tremoring work and breath work that is not able to be accomplished in a conversation. So I mean a conversation, a therapeutic conversation like Freudian therapy, right? But also in this dialogical conversation in which the irrational is not valued. I mean, I heard you say, Angie, something like the reasonable and the rational is the path to this virtue and to the divine. I might be misquoting you, but in this work, it's not about just the rational. It's about shaking the dog by the tail. So normally we think of the dog as wagging the tail, but the metaphor is that, you know, by shaking the body, the mind will somehow let go of some of its less happy constructs, less useful constructs, and then be able to rebuild. So that's where the weird stuff is happening in higher ed. And as somebody who is teaching in one of those departments, the faculty I do pay the price with my colleagues. Normally, I mean, you guys are perfectly friendly. maybe not, but I mean, I feel very open to talk about this here. But I think that there is a lot of very understandable fear that students enter society right now not being able to think clearly. And so everybody in liberal education is doing their best just to get them to the point where they can think clearly and that they can discern fake news and they can, you know, reframe all this information that's coming at them. And they see in these practices that are done in theater and music and dance a kind of threat to the rational. I get it. I do. But I also feel that the embodied practices are the pathway that we have to offer. And I'm so excited to hear what the next panel will say about that. So what can we do? What is to be done, quote unquote? how can we make these experiences available to our students, to the next generation, because they need to have access to this, even if they don't belong to a religion, and some of them belong to a religion and still don't have those experiences or think that it's possible. I was like that. So there's got to be some way to help the next generation, and that's the challenge I would put to you. How can we teach this?
Thank you, man. Okay, so that means we have 20 minutes for discussion. The floor is open. Okay, we will repeat the question before we answer it, which also means you actually have to ask a question in a form that we can repeat. Okay, let's see. Phil, first.
Just focusing on Anne's very, very recent final and very passionate talk there. It's a small point, really, and it's a PR point. I wonder, it seems like you're struggling getting people to take this seriously. I wonder whether it might be better to frame it as, rather than irrational, as irrational. Because it doesn't seem to me that what you're describing, and maybe I'm misunderstanding, is contrary to reason, is which to my mind is sort of by definition doing what's bad for you or, you know, counter to the rational. But it's just separate from rational processes and rational guidance of thought and action. So maybe if we say it's irrational rather than irrational, that might frame it in a way that is more palatable to people. I don't know. But
yeah, I mean, it's good.
Hold on, you got to repeat that first.
Oh.
Or do you want me to repeat it?
Would framing would framing these processes that I've discussed as irrational make them more palatable to those who feel that reason should be our highest calling?
Yes.
Is that about right?
And now you get to answer it.
Not necessarily that reason is our highest calling, because I think people maybe don't necessarily think reason is the only thing, but maybe hear the word irrational and think if it's counter to reason, that just sort of sounds kind of negative. But if it's not counter to reason, it's just a different thing to the rational or the irrational, then
I do. I mean, I think that's a great idea. I guess I'd have to look at the dictionary a little bit more to see. But okay, so the reason I'm kind of making the irrational my friend is because in the course of those experiences, you can imagine being buried, you have a lot of emotions that I have been told are like quintessential ingredients of irrationality. Like that's, no, John?
Yeah, I think the idea that emotion is antithetical to rationality is deeply mistaken.
Is wrong. Okay, that's
great. It's been sort of soundly rejected in the last 20 years of cognitive science.
Oh, that's so great. Well, you know, I just went to college before 20 years ago.
Yeah.
I wasn't trying to age you.
Yeah.
Did you want to respond to that too, Angie, or?
Yeah, well, yes, thank you. I mean, I had the similar thought while listening to Anne's really, which in fact, I would love all university students to have a music or theatre or dance lesson each week. Yeah, I mean, Plato has categories of the rational, the non-rational, and the irrational. I mean, so the non-rational can be neutral. It's just something we're not focusing on. He is very clear that reason itself is deeply passionate, deeply emotional. It has different aims. So one of the reasons I love ancient Greek philosophy is it does not work with this early modern distinction between reason and desire, which I find hugely unhelpful. And it really comes in with Hume and Kant in the 18th century, though it was prefigured the century before. So I personally think Philip's suggestion really helps.
That's good.
You.
I mean, can you think of another word that doesn't even have rational in it? Like, yeah. I think what we're talking about is.
I use the word sapiential.
Okay. Wisdom.
Sapiential, it means having to do with wisdom.
Mm-hmm.
It's different from emotional. It's different from cognitive. It's different from intellectual. It's an actual word.
Hands up. Hands. Giovanna?
Latin might help in the sense that irrational is irrational, so opposite to rational. Irrational would be away from rational, but you could call it ex rational, which means out of reason. So on the side of it, like egregious means out of the flock.
So you
could call it ex rational.
pro-abortion pro-choice. Right. Yeah. I'd rather pick a word that isn't rational.
Yeah.
Like noose or something. Noosey.
No wedding.
I'm sorry.
No wedding.
Okay. Well, someone already got
all right,
that.
I think we need to move on from Phil's very interesting provocation and all the different possible Greek and Latin solutions to it. And we're going to go to Giovanna first, and then back to you, John, and then Sarah.
So I come to this conversation as an anthropologist, and in particular as an anthropologist of magic. So what I teach to my students is it's similar to what you teach to your student, I think. But we use magic as a filter, magic as participatory consciousness, as non-rational way of knowing that is nonetheless sound and part of our being human, as you know, a way to frame this type of discourse. So I feel one of the discourses and conversation that we have in class is that theater and arts are now one of the few spaces in, you know, Western, so-called Western world in which we can experience, you know, the world as in a participatory way, and the boundaries of ourselves that go beyond the individual. So I just want to put magic into this conversation as a possible, you know, way to frame also this type of discourses. That's it.
Okay. Sarah Ben and then John.
I just want to say in response to and this sort of thicket you're raising, Shravana and I are in the midst of putting together a, waiting for the final word on an edited volume on embodied pedagogies in the study of religion. And part of the aim of this is not to forward one theory, but to really get a bunch of different people in the study of religion who are working in sort of different subfields who are playing with exploring forms of embodiment as necessary for cultivating the knowing capacity to encounter the material they're trying to teach, to talk about what they're doing and to think through why they're doing what they're doing and what effects it has. And I think, you know, one of the goals of this is to see what language surfaces in that process and to sort of cleave open this conversation, not in a place of contestation, but really in a sort of collaborative, generative way, in part because I think we don't have natural ways right now to talk about this, but it's going on in many places without being surfaced. And I think one of the goals, it's not the only one for us, is to see how people are talking and thinking about what they're doing. Because I think we do have an impoverishment of language in English and within the sort of epistemic structure that we work in for thinking about this. And we could talk about a reason, but what does that mean to someone out there, outside of sort of the discourse on this level, or the same with sort of John's suggestion? So there's this question of, I think there's a call right now to see how people are thinking and playing with this in different corners, in part to really cultivate a network of people thinking, but also the vocabulary and the concepts that may actually give us some footing for doing what we're talking about.
Yeah.
I'd like to just make a meta comment. Meta, thank you, John, before we go to John, which is that none of the comments so far have raised the word wisdom, which is ostensibly the panel and the weekend. So just curious, what are we, how does this have to, can we bring it back to wisdom? Just a gentle invitation. John?
Okay, I'll take up the invitation. I wanted to convey first to you and that I belong to a growing movement, mostly on social media, YouTube, internet, addressing what we're calling the meaning crisis, which is what you just articulated. I did a 50-hour series on awakening from the meaning crisis, trying to answer the question you posed. We even hashtagged it. We call ourselves this little corner of the internet to try and be as unpretentious as possible. But one of the things, one of the ways we articulate this is how to talk to the nuns, the N-O-N-E-S's, without offending the nuns, the N-U-N's. I think that's a very serious and important challenge. And the question I want to pose is, and it brings it down to Charles's invitation, is one of the ways I've tried to articulate the meaning crisis is as a wisdom famine. And I want to know what you think of that, because I can do the following with my students. I can say, where do you go for knowledge? Or information, and their phones go up like reflex action.
Yeah.
And where do you go for knowledge? And they'll sort of hesitate a bit because they've been drenched in sort of watered down postmodernism. And they'll say, the science? And they want to say, where do you go for wisdom? And that's what you get. You get an anxious, anxious silence. And so I'm wondering if you see a connection between crisis and wisdom famine.
Yes.
Well, great. Okay.
I can talk more about that, but maybe.
Well, I'd like to hear a little bit more about that, if that's okay.
Okay. Sure. Yes, okay, so this friend of mine who was buried and rose again, you know, he walks through the world in a very different way, having confronted in a real way, like in a kind of sensual way, his death. And there are experiences like that that somehow, I mean, I feel that the experiences of, for example, the wonder and the awe and kind of being connected to all things at once and all that kind of stuff, those things, if the experiencer remembers, right? I mean, I've asked people, so what's the point of doing all these, you know, transitory experiences? You have this experience, and every time it's been, be the witness, remember. Just remember. Don't react, it somehow transforms the frame in which you move through the world, and questions of meaning are not as heavy. They're not, maybe they should be, but the meaningfulness of, you know, what does today ask of me? Even the smallest, this is like Frankl, those smallest interactions are enough. And I don't know exactly how it happens. I don't know why those experiences that kind of remove the architecture of the whole house, and then you are forced to rebuild a house that has fewer walls, or, you know, like you have to build it up again yourself, and somehow that's...
So just a quick follow-up, because, I mean, I had something very similar when I did the Return to the Source last summer. The horizon of horror wasn't a joke, right? So do you think the encounter with horror, broadly construed, like this kind of confrontation with mortality, do you think that's an integral part of the cultivation of wisdom?
Yeah. I mean, I don't know if it's the only thing.
No, I didn't say that. But
like, you've got those, I think that, I think the next panel might be able to help us, because there are traditions like the Tibetan Buddhist tradition where you go to sleep in a graveyard, or, you know, you eat meat, or you have sex with whatever. I mean, all these kind of really shocking things. I mean, maybe having sex these days out of marriage is not that shocking. But, like, for somebody, if you are, I'm trying to imagine, you know, if you're somebody who's brought up in a culture where it's very kind of prescribed, then any step across those boundaries of behavior is really, you know, it's horror.
Okay, but I want to let Angie respond, and then maybe we'll have time for one more question, and that will be Julia's.
So apologies for going back to ancient Greece again.
It may
be helpful to this conversation to think that in Homer, in the Iliad, the initial meaning of Sophia, which we translate wisdom, the initial meaning was to do with practical skill. Mm-hmm. And then it very quickly becomes to mean various other kinds of wisdom as well. But practical skill is absolutely in there. So the kind of learning and growth through embodied practices in theatre, in music, in dance that Anne's been discussing, that could be incorporated by Sophia. So I'm fine with embodied Sophia, embodied wisdom. I wasn't here last year, but I think this seems to be flowing on really well from what you all discussing last year, that embodied wisdom, embodied Sophia. And then you haven't got I understand why you don't want rational or irrational, irrational or non-rational. I understand why you don't want that in there at all. Mm. But Sophia can cover that. Or wisdom can cover that.
All right, Julia, you get the last question.
Okay. Thank you. This is a very interesting panel all around. is somewhat odd because I generally tend to study the ancient world, but my question actually is also for Anne. So you began your remarks by talking about some suspicion around men publicizing abstract concepts in a feminine person, which resonated with me. I really liked that. And I do want to speak with you afterwards because I have two 8th century female composers, rather obscure female composers, that I think you would like to meet. One of whom writes a hymn called It Is Wondrous to Me. So, but in any case, you've said some interesting things about, you know, in the project you're doing and building this catalog, that you hope you're not personifying the divine, but you're investigating this tradition. And again, I'm not talking about wisdom necessarily, but the feminine element, I think, has repeated throughout this conversation on all of our panelists. So you hope you're not personifying the divine, but you're investigating this tradition of the female lineage. So I guess my question is, are you, if you're not personifying the divine, are you personifying those women and their femininity, or are you trying to create something new and to help your students create something new? And in that case, do you have, in either case actually, do you need to be, this kind of goes back to Professor Stang on Christ taking on that feminine person with his personhood, do you need to be a female to either embody those women or to create something new in their lineage or not?
Okay, what was the first one?
Well, I'm mostly interested in this, in the last question I posed, which is, are you creating something new, or are you embodying these women that you're building this catalog around? And if you're creating something new, are you at the end of that lineage and building on the lineage, or are you trying to embody this lineage?
Yeah.
And for the students that you're training, do they need to have some feminine element themselves in order to either embody that lineage or to join it?
Okay, so I'm not trying to embody those women, although just because it's performance, the intersection of the audience's gaze and what happens on stage results in the audience thinking that because I'm singing the words of this woman, they may think that I'm embodying, but I'm not. I don't feel that happening. I don't think that you need to be, I have yet to hire a guy to sing these songs, but I'm not opposed, right? That's fine. And really, it's a stealthy way for me as a music professor in a fairly traditional music department that teaches a lot of Beethoven and Wagner to establish, it does a lot of things while I am pursuing the thing that's really interesting to me. It can be perceived as a feminist project. I'm at a women's college.